Well, welcome again, everyone, to our conference. I would like to invite our panel speakers here. This is the plenary session, and we are very honored to have economists, regulators, policymakers, and also academia. So let me introduce them as they come to the podium.
I'm here.
So may I introduce to you on my furthest right is Madam Choi Li. Choi Li is actually, I think, is a long-term observer and as well as a very well-known chief economist. We all know she's working in CCB Securities and she's the chief economist there and managing director. She's well-known for her insights into the China capital markets and also her understanding of the economic policy across the Greater China area. So welcome, Choi Li. The next one is actually initially not in our agenda, but I think we are very thankful for NFRA, the newly conned National Financial Regulatory Authority. For those who are not familiar with the English name, maybe you were familiar with the Chinese name, Jingguan Zhongzhu. We've now got Jingguan Zhongzhu, Director Huo, incidentally, also Director Huo. So if you got a surname Huo, probably you can get a position in a regulator. So Director Huo Hongqiang is a director from NFRA. He just arrived last night. So welcome, Hongqiang.
Thank you.
Welcome. So we've got a regulator in person. And also somebody who also just arrived from Beijing. So welcome. We've got Sabino. Sabino is a long-term friend as well with ASIFMA. Sabino Fornies Martinez, he is the Minister Counsellor in Economic and Financial Affairs Section, EU Delegation from Beijing. He also just flew in, so welcome, Sabino.
Thank you.
And finally, also somebody who just freshly flown in from Beijing, Professor Zhang Xiaoyan, also a very good friend of ours. She's Chair Professor of Finance and Associate Dean at the Business School in Tsinghua, Jinrong Sheyuan, the Fu Yuan Zhang. So welcome, Professor Zhang. So without further ado, I think we've got only 40 minutes, and definitely if you're interested in the bio, you can go into the QR code, but I would like to start the first question and see how we can actually take it up, especially having heard from the three leading keynote speakers from market, from the regulator in Hong Kong, also from the regulator in Beijing. So there's actually, I think both regulators in Beijing and Hong Kong also mentioned about the fact that the economic landscape is getting more complex. It is not without challenges for people who are going into China to invest. And also there is a kind of recurring theme that we have been hearing in the last few months in particular is the question of, is China still investable? I'm sure this is something you want to ask all the time. This is a billion-dollar question you dare not ask. So I'll do it for you as an association CEO. So let me ask, first of all, Choi Li, okay, what's your take? I mean, obviously there were cyclical movements in the economy, but at the same time, there were also external challenges globally. So over to you, I would like to hear what is your answer and what is your response to this kind of questions? Probably you've been asked many times already in your house.
Thank you, Alice, and it's a pleasure to join this panel. I think think about the investment themes, the China risk question is actually not new. I remember 10 years ago, after the global financial crisis, there was a lot of discussion about whether China was going to be stuck in a debt trap because of the stimulus. Yet more than 10 years later, we have witnessed a very strong consumption boom, tech sector booming, and a lot of upgrades in the economy. So I would say, you know, taking a longer term perspective, it's still a country fast growing. There are a lot of investment opportunities. Of course, it's investable. You just have to be patient and look at things in a granular way, not very you know, top down, but you need to also think as a developing country where it's going structurally. A little bit near term, I guess people are wondering about the China's cyclical picture. That's what's on people's mind these days. I would say, you know, at the beginning of the year, the government gave a 5% growth target. You know, people took this a little bit in a mixed way. I think the signal was very clear. There won't be a strong stimulus like in 2008. The economy would recover in an organic way, which means it will be slower. But it also helps a country to recover in a more sustainable way. If you think about the Western economies, what it went through after the pandemic, there was very strong stimulus. There was also a lot of inflation. And during afterwards, the policymakers need to deal with disinflation and controlling debt at the same time. So you have this delicate policy balance in the West where you, if you tighten too much, then there's a risk to the debt. And if you tighten too little, the inflation is not controlled. So I think by having a more gradual or targeted policy environment like in China, not a big stimulus, it's actually conducive to a more sustainable recovery. And also, I think the recovery is not, it is taking place. It's actually in line with what we have expected at the beginning of the year. You have a big rebound at the start right after the pandemic, but the pace will slow down. But if you look at the different sectors, services is repairing, housing is not really surging, but it's stabilizing. Housing market is stabilizing. And more importantly, I would say in the medium to longer run, the economy is going through a transition from property-led to manufacturing upgrade-led. And that trend is very much in place. If you look at manufacturing investment in the green sector, tech sector, high-tech sector, it's all very strong. And I would also say people are quite worried about the trade relationship of China with the world, but actually, despite all this protectionism talks, China's trade actually increased 30% after the pandemic, before and after the pandemic. So it's actually supply chain. We can talk about that more, but supply chain is shifting. But China certainly trade is a very strong part of the economy still, and actually it's moving up the value chain. Just think about auto exports. It's a new area of growth. It's surging so much in the last few years. So that's a testament to China's competitiveness and manufacturing upgrade. So I think my general take is, yes, we are at a point of a recovery, and people have obviously always will have a lot of questions, but one needs to be patient and also look long term. And I think also in the near term, one question, just to be on the balance side, one question people do wonder is the job growth, right? And I think it is area that requires policy support. I think job growth recovery has been relatively lagging behind despite economic improvement. So I think that area probably should be a policy focus in the coming months and quarters to aid this economic recovery. Nevertheless, I don't think credit stimulus is a big focus in the policy side, on the policy side. I'll start with this macro picture. I know there will be a lot of policy discussions coming, but I want to just answer this investability questions from an economic perspective.
Right, thank you, Trilly. This is obviously a very insightful sharing at the start. Having regard to the time frame that people will have to look at things, and as we just heard also, a lot of these are really long-term policy measures as exemplified by or shared by some of our regulatory authorities. Now, that is very much from the inside of Asia's angle, and just want to like pivot a bit to outside Asia. People who come from Asia from probably will know the culture here and understand demographics. What about coming from the EU space, from a policy observer and policy analyst perspective? Sabino, how would you advise international players in the light of all these challenges around, and having heard what Chaley also mentioned about the recovery phase and the economic transition right now in China?
Yeah, thank you. Yes, I mean, from our perspective, I mean, from a policy perspective, I mean, what we think is that the China investability, it's a matter to be decided by the investors themselves. From a policy making, what we need to do is to create the conditions in order for these investors to take their own decisions in a safe and secure way. Safe for them, but also safe for our jurisdictions. So in this sense, I mean, I think that there are some key elements that are very important for us. One is the openness and the level playing field. So, I mean, in as much as, for example, I am talking from the perspective of the European Union, we are in financial services, we are an open market, where everybody can invest and where everybody can establish, even from outside the EU, and then it can provide services all over the EU when we are talking to other jurisdictions, and in this case, China, we will be requesting them the same. And we cannot say for the time being that the conditions in order to invest and establish yourself in financial services in China are the same than in the EU. So there is still some way to go. We have made some advancements and China has been opening during the last years substantially, but still we need many things to do in that respect in terms of openness of their capital markets, eliminate quotas and be more proactive in that sense. If China wants to have a real top class capital market, which in my opinion now they are still a little bit far away from that. In some areas it is comparable, but in some other areas I would say that they need to do some more. So this is from the point of view of openness and level playing field. There is also this issue that you were mentioning. We are also in a changing political landscape. The COVID and the war on Ukraine have put economic security as one very important, relevant topic, at least in the EU, but I would say in many other countries. And we are looking into it. I mean, this is not anything against China, but it's true that we will have to manage our economic relationships in a way also that protects our interests and the interest of our citizens. You have seen, for example, and I think this is a very clear example, what has happened with the gas, excessive reliance in one country for the supply of one very important element for your economy. I mean, it has proved not to be a good choice. So now what we are doing, and we have, for example, last week we published the communication where we explain how we are looking at this so-called de-risking, or is more about economic security, which, by the way, is not anti-China, and of course we want to do in the most open way possible. So we are analyzing which are our dependencies, and we will come with policies in order to try to deal with them. So that's the second part, and the third part I would say is also stability from a policy perspective. When you are promoting, or when you are trying to allow your investors to invest in other countries, I mean, what you don't want is them to be investing in areas where financial stability is not safeguarded, or it is not looked at in the same way as we look at it. There are not sufficient elements to be sure that there will not be elements of financial instability. Why? Because the more interrelated your economies are, the more possible a contagion can happen. So, I mean, for us it's also very important, and not only for China, but for many, for all the other jurisdictions, that the financial stability is looked upon in the same way as it's agreed by international standards. And in this way, we are also looking at and concerned about the elements of financial stability in China, in the same way as I believe that the Chinese probably are looked into our, for example, small banks or what's happening in the US small banks. I mean, we can be just concerned and be looking at about what's going on the local government debt, the transparency of the level of indebtedness of the Chinese banking sector, which are elements that would indicate that there could be some type of contagion. And I think that I will stay there, yes, mentioning.
Thank you, Sabino. That's a very good sharing from the, really from a non-Asian perspective, but also from an international community that is hoping to continue its presence and investment in China. A lot of takeaways, in particular, you just mentioned financial stability, I think is a common theme that we have heard from our fellow regulators all over the world. So I think lots will be done at the financial stability board level and how to actually address those interconnectedness of different markets as and when China is opening up more and more. Sabine also raised a very good point. China definitely aspires to become a world-class capital market, but we mustn't forget that the fact that China is still within the emerging market space. So I think this is a very tall order that China has to answer to. So with that tall order and all this international investors' expectation, I will pass the hot potato now to Hongqiang, okay? Being the regulator, being in now the China's most powerful regulatory authority that combines the banking supervision, that combines investor protection function, as well as obviously the insurance sector's regulation, both prudential and conduct. Don't forget, both banks, insurance, whether it's firm individuals are now subject to the NFRA's supervision. Now, with such a big, you know, as Spider-Man said, right, or Spider-Man's Uncle Ben said, with great responsibility. This is the great power comes with great responsibility. So how do you answer and respond to what the international investors are hoping to see in terms of level playing field, continual openness, commitment on stability? Let me hear from you, Hongqiang.
thank you, Alice. And I want to correct that it's not powerful, but just take more responsibility. So it's not, it means a lot of more work. It's not that more power. First of all, thank you for inviting me to this great event. It's a great pleasure to have this opportunity to share my views with all the guests. I came here last night and especially to convey clear messages to the industry and to give more confidence to all the guests, and also that create more opportunities to have face-to-face communications. My remarks are mainly from the banking and the insurance perspectives, which are key players in the capital markets. As we all know that the opening up of China's financial market was accelerated since China's accession to the WTO. Especially since 2018, that we have published 34 opening up measures in banking and insurance sectors. Now we have completed all the revision work of relevant laws and regulations, which give foreign financial institutions more certainty and confidence. Regarding the opening up, I just want to highlight some keywords for your reference. The first keyword is the wholly foreign owned. Now we have foreign banks and insurance case set up wholly foreign owned subsidiaries in China. There are already examples of wholly foreign owned insurance holding company, wholly foreign insurance asset management company, and we see more and more wholly foreign owned life insurance companies entering China market. And also that the second keyword is the prudential licensing. Prudential licensing. We have eliminated certain quantitative requirements in licensing, such as the total assets, operation years. And we now emphasize on comprehensive assessment, which allows, it's not, we're just aiming allowing more market access to more small and medium-sized but highly specialized financial institutions. The third keyword is specialized. We encourage specialized foreign financial institutions to enter specific market segments, such as wealth management, pension, etc. We have proved the establishment of 5 foreign-controlled wealth management companies, 4 of which have opened for business. We have approved a foreign financial group to invest in CCB pension manager company. The fourth keyword is the same business scope. We have expanded the business scope of foreign banks and foreign insurance brokerage company. We approved foreign financial institution to participate in the pension wealth management pilot program. Foreign banks have brought their expertise in derivatives trading, asset management, custody service, small and medium-sized business financing, commodity trade financing, etc. And foreign insurance companies have brought their skills and experiences in pension, health insurance, agriculture insurance, and liability insurance. Open Up has been playing a very important role in promoting the development of China's banking and insurance market. We have seen more and more foreign financial institutions in different types. Besides traditional banks and insurers, we have seen foreign-controlled wealth management companies, foreign insurance holding company, foreign pension company, foreign insurance asset management company. They are developing very fast and have become important market players. We have seen more and more professional financial products. Foreign banks and insurers have fully leveraged the advantage of their parent companies to provide targeted financial products and services, such as wealth management, overseas wealth management business on behalf of domestic clients, derivatives trading, etc. They are quite successful in these areas. We are happy to see that. We have seen that foreign financial institutions also help us to improve our regulatory framework. We have joined an international standard to revise our regulatory requirements on capital adequacy to increase the stability of the financial system. To give you a taste of what we have done last year, we have, I will give you some concrete examples. In 2022, we approved Schroders, Bocom Wells, Goldman Sachs, ICBC Wells, and LBBW, it's from German, Shanghai branch to open for business. We have BlackRock, CCB Wells to participate in China's pension wealth management pilot. And Dashin Bank, which already has a bank subsidiary in mainland China, was approved to have a foreign bank branch license, make it the first foreign bank with 2 kinds of banking licenses. We approved BNP Paribas to increase equity in consumer finance company. There will be a long list. I'll just give you some examples. Here, I want to take this opportunity to reiterate our opening up policy. Chinese state leaders have made clear on many occasions that China will continue to promote high-level opening up and relax market access. The door of China's opening up will only become wider and wider. A few days ago, Minister Liun Ze of the National Financial Regulatory Administration reiterated 3 will not change during a session with foreign-funded financial institutions in Shanghai. The opening up policy to further attract and utilize foreign investment in the financial sector will not change. The protection of the legitimate rights and interests of foreign investment will not change. The commitment to further improving the business environment for foreign-funded financial institutions will not change. In future, we will continue to work on more opening up measures to encourage foreign financial institutions to come to China or expand its business in China. Firstly, we will carefully review the different supervisory treatment for foreign and domestic financial institutions. We will further eliminate the different requirements regarding licensing and business operation. aiming for national treatment in every aspect. Secondly, we will fully consider the characteristics and realities of foreign financial institutions in China. We will have differentiated regular requirements in our daily supervision. We'll create a more friendly and encouraging environment for foreign financial institutions in China. Thirdly, we will actively participate in international standard setting. We will work to make international standards more representative, reflecting the situations of different markets. At the same time, we will promote the implementation of international standards in China. We welcome foreign financial institutions to contact us through ASIFMA and or directed to us for your expectations and concerns. We'll carefully consider that in our future work. Thank you, Alice.
Yeah. Thank you, Hongqiang. I think this is really music to our ears, especially when Hongqiang actually mentioned from the NFRA's regulator perspective, they are taking a more holistic approach towards regulating on a daily basis the daily supervision of foreign banks operating on China soil. There will be a kind of more tailor-made, bespoke, and more risk-based supervisory approach. So international firms who set up their branches subsidiaries will be treated in a way that is commensurate with the international standing and size and international standards, if I could recap, you know, in that way. So I guess that is really, really a new and also very bold message that we haven't heard for a very, very long time about China banking supervision approach, because we were reading a lot of news about people who actually got you know, penalized and got heavy fines. But I guess this is really good news, which is also the news that actually brought to us in person by Hongqiang, flying over from Beijing. So I'm very thankful for that, and very encouraging news as well. So I guess, you know, China, obviously China market has got a lot of appeal, as Chae Lee just mentioned. It's a huge economy that people would not be able to ignore, also resonating with what Julia Leung said this morning. That said, also when we talk to some of our member firms, they are also very attracted to the fact that it's a very deep liquid market in many aspects as well. Partly, I think, because China has a huge population and China capital markets also participated you know, strongly by their retail investors. But like all retail investors, sentiment could flip-flop all the time, and it could not be as predictable and as robust sometimes on taking a long-term view. So, and I understand NFRA also has investor protection, financial education, new functions now transferred. Now, I will not buck you for a time being, Hongqiang. I will give you a briefing space. I would like to hear from Professor Zhang. Professor Zhang has been studying and also researching on a lot of investor behavior in China markets, capital markets. For those who have the bandwidth to read, she just published a white paper with her students, many hundred pages. I only read the executive summary, but it's very impressive about the way she analyzed the market behavior within China, especially the A stocks and all this. And also, I think with all this policy response and recently also the 20th Congress policy statements made by the central government, is there any sort of forecast you can make or any analysis you can share with us about possible change in the China market structure, investor behavior, and also the entrance of even more institutional investors? Or do you see people actually taking a neutral stance or sitting on the fence and not investing as much to open up their businesses as brokers or asset managers or participating in banking or insurance? What's your analysis from the central policy perspective, given the 20th you know, Congress report, as well as how the individual, you know, market responds to that in the market when they invest? Over to you, Xiaoyan.
Okay. Well, thank you, Alice, for a bunch of very important questions. Over the past few years, I spent a lot of time working on a topic called foreign capital in Chinese market. I believe everybody here would like to know what we find. So we look at the foreign capital coming into China through QFII, RQFII, Connect, all kinds of Connect programs. We want to see how do they do in Chinese market. And what we found was very interesting. We find the trade flows of all foreign institutional investors can significantly predict what's happening in the stock. We're looking at the stock level price movement and so on and so forth. So this very strong predictability makes us believe that, you know, foreign investors, they actually contribute substantially to the price discovery process. Okay, and then we look into how come you guys can know where the price is going next day. And then we look into their information processing. We want to know whether the foreign investors can process local news, firm level news, or market level news. And the answer is yes, they contribute to information efficiency in Chinese market as well. Of course, all the relaxations of regulations like a quota and investability that helps the predictability of foreign capital in Chinese market. So I guess my first point is very simple. I believe everybody here, as well as regulators, they all realize that foreign capital is a very important part of a booming Chinese capital market. You guys help to do price discovery to improve the information efficiency. That's why we keep this idea of we want to open up the Chinese market to all the high quality institutional capital flows. That's number one. Number two, Alice mentioned that over most recent years, we're just coming out of COVID-19 and there are a lot of uncertainties or new developments in the global capital market. How do we think about the policy? Over the 20th Congress meeting, there is the mentioning of regulation enhancement and high-quality capital market. What do we think about that? You know, I'm academic, and my perspective is quite simple. I believe Hongqiang mentioned a lot about, you know, how they want those things to be interpreted. To me, for instance, for the regulation enhancement, my take is there are two points. Number one is, you know, the regulation, you know, the regulators, they're also conducting, it's a system, right? It's a very complicated job. When the market is developing, when the global environment is changing, they need to adapt to the new environment, and they want to integrate the financial regulation system. And the purpose is very simple. It's to improve the regulation efficiency. That's number one. And number two is, given so many uncertainties in the global capital market, I believe Sabino also mentioned that financial stability is also very important. So that's what I read from the regulation change. And in terms of a high quality capital market, Hongqiang mentioned many times, and I believe everybody here must be hearing this a lot, one very important pillar of a high-quality capital market is to have high-quality foreign capital. So when I read into those regulation announcements, what I feel like is, you know, high-quality foreign capital has been doing very well in the past in China. Oh, I should mention that, you know, when we look at QV, RQV, Connect programs, you know, all the foreign institutions, they actually make a positive and a very significant returns in China. The foreign capital, from my point of view, from my perspective, the foreign capital come to China for two reasons. Number one is because China has great growth potential. And number two, it's for international diversification. And now, because you're doing so well in the past, and the regulators are trying to build this environment for high regulatory efficiency and to opening up to a high level. So my take on this is great information. And Cui Li also mentioned that the China macro economy is recovering, and which is great. I think, you know, my take on this, those are all good signals. But of course, every foreign institution has to make their own decisions for this long-term involvement in the developing of a high-quality Chinese capital market. All right, that's what I have.
I think that's the dynamics and the beauty of a capital market. There will be what we call risk taker, there will be risk underwriter, and there will be people who do avoid risk. Because otherwise, there will be just one direction for the flow. So I guess this is a very important message, and this is also something we quite conveniently come to the point of risk. Because we've heard pretty positive policy commitments and signals and opening up. That is for a very long term, as we all know, you know, policy deliverables. But in the meantime, there is also also challenges about market sentiment, cyclical economic you know, downturn in different places in the world, and also new phraseology being coined every day. So we kind of heard the DE term start with DE all the time, and now we have now migrate or it morph into de-risking, you know, the notion of de-risking. Now, I've got only 4 minutes, so I could not go into in-depth. So maybe I just invite Sabino to say something about the risking, and then the final goal, I would actually hope Che Li can respond a bit on that as well. So okay, Sabino, you've got 2 minutes.
Thank you, Alex. very briefly. I mean, I think that the term de-risking, but I would call it economic security. Because, I mean, the risking is like if you are just targeting some countries or something like that, I'm going to take more less risk from this or that country. We are not necessarily into that game. We are in the game of safeguarding economic security, I guess, in the EU, but in all the other Western economies, from what I have understood from the G7. I mean, this applies mostly to some type of technologies or to some type of raw materials that are absolutely necessary in order to keep your economy going. From what I have understood, and if you read the different papers that have been produced, even at policy level, the financial sector is not a sector that is necessarily directly affected by the de-risking itself. Of course, it could be affected indirectly in as much as there would be investment on this or that other type of companies that could have some impact on the de-risking, on the economic security strategy. Sorry for the for the thing. I think I can stay there. Thank you.
Thank you, Sabino. Shirley, you want to respond?
Sure. I think, you know, the message that there is no decoupling but risk management, I guess that's a positive. But for financial market, I feel that maybe people feel that not much will change from the previous baseline. One, supply chain is reconfiguring, and, you know, there will be some diversification, there will be regionalization. In some industries, there will be some localization. And I think financial industry obviously needs to pay attention to those changes. And another thing I think is the response to that. And as we discussed very extensively, China market is opening up incrementally, but surely. And China still is a big market for investment returns and diversification. So I think from that perspective, there is a lot of opportunities for financial industries. And I also think, you know, for China itself, there is a lot of risk management to be done, as well as Sabio mentioned at the start. You know, one area I think going forward would be fiscal reforms. There will be a lot of issues related to the local debt issues, for instance, and that's all the more reason why macro policy need to be prudent. But related to the financial market opening, I think one big opportunity in Hong Kong, as Julia also mentioned earlier, is the rising renminbi market in Hong Kong. And I think that's going to be an important theme in the coming years as well, partly because of the interest rate environment globally, partly because the Chinese market is becoming more connected to the outside world, also because there are a lot more financial products to help manage financial risks. So I think, you know, there is a complex range of response to the shifting landscape.
Yeah, definitely. So this is a very good final note, actually, from the panel about how do the you know, we should actually position ourselves in the world which is very complex, ever evolving, and also going through different phases of transition. As Xiaoyan just mentioned, China is committed towards developing high quality market. I think we, in one of the formula for having a high quality market is to have high quality talents. I think Hong Kong is not short of that, and as we can see from our panel speakers. So can I invite everyone to give a big round of applause to our high quality panel speakers. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.